Michael Jackson and Paul McCartney are two of the world's most famous and celebrated musicians of the 20th century. And they had a complex relationship that spanned several decades, becoming close friends while collaborating musically and then publicly feuding with each other in the press after Michael took control of the near entire Beatles catalog as part of his purchase of ATV Music Publishing. McCartney felt betrayed and was incensed by what Jackson chose to do next. This rivalry documented in full as part of our initial investigation. In this video, we give you, the viewer, a much-needed update. What ultimately happened to the Beatles catalog after Jackson's sudden passing? Were the rumors that he gifted them back to McCartney in his will ever true? And has Paul McCartney ever been able to reclaim his legacy of Beatles music since? Here's the detail. But first, let's put things into context. The two first met in the 1970s when McCartney expressed an interest in writing music for the artist's solo projects when Jackson was still a member of the Jacksons. Paul offered songs to Michael and they eventually became friends, even collaborating in the studio together on a few songs, including Say 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 and The Girl Is Mine, the latter being the lead single from Jackson's seminal 1982 record, Thriller. Jackson admired the ex-Beatle for his incredible success and unmatched contribution to popular music. During this period, McCartney took the former child star under his wing, enlightening him about the harsh realities of the music business. Lessons he and his former bandmates learned having made crucial mistakes in the Beatles, which resulted in them losing the publishing to all the music they created and made world famous. How that happened, we won't get into now. The whole scenario, as well as how the songs got into Michael Jackson's hands, is explained in a dedicated video we did on the subject. So, check that out if you want to hear more. Their relationship would become a lot more strained as the 1980s progressed. When Paul felt Michael took the insight he gave his collaborator and used it against him by gaining the publishing rights to essentially all Beatles music as part of purchasing the ATV catalog in 1985. McCartney had been interested in buying the rights himself, but after the record-selling success of Thriller and therefore the landslide of royalties that had accumulated, Jackson simply had the funds and sheer tenacity to offer well over McCartney's bid when it came to the negotiations, a whopping $47.5 million, the equivalent of $134 million today, making Jackson instantly the most powerful individual in all of music publishing. After the deal was made, Paul chose to reframe the outward betrayal into a positive thing. At least his most prized legacy of music was in the hands of another artist and a friend, who he hoped would be more respectful and fairer than some faceless corporate entity. McCartney would make several attempts to contact Jackson in hopes that they could negotiate higher royalty rates for his music, and that the singer-songwriter could have more of an influence on how and where his music will be used. However, a lot had changed since their time in the studio together as Michael Jackson's soaring fame catapulted him into a whole new level of superstardom. He had a lot riding on McCartney's songs now, and Michael was determined to make his investment pay up. Their relationship continued to deteriorate in the following years as McCartney publicly criticized Jackson for overly commercializing the Beatles' music, for example, allowing Nike to license the song Revolution for a much-publicized campaign, believing it cheapened the political statement he was making in the track by allowing it to be used to sell sneakers. Quote, "It kind of spoils it. Just takes the edge off. Our songs are tending to get a little commercialized now, which I'm not too wild on," Paul said in an interview. Jackson, in turn, reportedly felt betrayed by McCartney's comments and stopped speaking to him altogether. Over the years, Jackson's net worth grew exponentially as the ATV catalog increased in value. In 1995, he merged ATV Music with Sony Music to form Sony ATV Music Publishing, in which Jackson retained 50% ownership of the company. Paul McCartney expressed resentment for the enormous wealth Michael amassed during these years on the back of his songs. While McCartney was forced to line Jackson's pockets in order to continue to work performing his written lyrics, their relationship never fully recovered, and they remained distant until Jackson's death in 2009.
You were the guy who said to Michael Jackson, you should get into publishing.
Isn't that great?
Yeah.
Do you love the irony?
And he bought all your songs.
Yeah.
And you said to him, listen, I'll give you fair market value. Let me buy my songs. I want to own them.
Mm.
And he won't do it.
I don't mind that because he, you know, had all the cash. Yeah. Someone was selling it and he bought it. What I don't like is that I've actually written to him a couple of times saying, Michael, don't you think after, like, even if I was just a writer on the payroll after 30 years
right.
of being reasonably successful for this company you now own, don't you think I could have a raise? And we've never talked about it. He won't even answer my letters.
Oh, my
so you
God.
Know what? We haven't got that great a relationship.
I did read recently that because of some cash flow problems he's having, aren't your songs up for grabs?
In fact, this might be a good time for me and you to go in and buy these songs.
Yeah.
You know, so
no, I think it may be true. I don't know. You know, you never know what's room and what isn't. I don't have access to his accounts. But, you know, the trouble is I wrote him for nothing.
Right.
And buying them back at these phenomenal sums is just...
It rubs you the wrong way.
I can't do it.
Some sources in the media speculated what would happen to the catalog of Beatles songs now Michael had passed. Was there a possibility that Michael Jackson would wish for them to be returned to their most logical recipient, Paul McCartney? Quote, some time ago, the media came up with the idea that Michael Jackson was going to leave his share in the Beatles songs to me in his will. McCartney wrote in a statement on his website. There had been speculation as to whether the King of Pop would bury the hatchet, business-wise anyway, and will the songs to McCartney. But that was not the case. Quote, don't believe everything you read, folks, McCartney said. In interviews, McCartney spoke fondly of their early collaborations and expressed regret that they had grown apart over the years. Quote, he was a lovely man, massively talented, and we miss him. Adding that after Jackson's purchase of the catalog, the two kind of drifted apart, but that despite rumors, there wasn't a big bust-up. We have a linked video of Paul McCartney talking about his relationship with Michael Jackson over the years, so check that out if you want to hear his thoughts on their ongoing feud. Immediately after his death at 50 years old, Sony Music took full control of the catalog Jackson had a stake in. 7 years later, in 2016, Sony ATV agreed to pay $750 million to the late performer's estate in order to buy out their remaining 50% stake in the company. As a result, the Beatles catalog alone was valued in excess of $1 billion, an unimaginable figure for McCartney to ever consider paying to get his songs back. However, Paul found a way to reclaim his songs through the U.S. Copyright Act of 1967, which was passed as a means to let songwriters regain the rights to their songs. The law states that for tracks published before 1978, rights can be reverted back to the original author after 56 years. In 2015, McCartney began the process of gaining the rights to some of his music under the act, filing to reclaim the rights to 32 songs as a number of titles from the highly coveted Lennon-McCartney catalog were on the eve of hitting the 56-year mark. With the first Beatles single, Love Me Do, coming up on its 56th anniversary after being released in 1962, and later songs potentially becoming available by 2026, according to Billboard. While this process was underway, a British court ruled that the U.S. Copyright Act did not apply in Great Britain, making it significantly harder for McCartney to legally secure the rights to his music globally. However, in July 2017, both Paul and Sony agreed to a private settlement out of court to avoid possibly a high-profile and lengthy legal battle. So, Paul regained the rights to his music in a private settlement. A big win for the former Beatle, who had been on this journey to secure the publishing of his own music for nearly 50 years. However, few details concerning the settlement have been disclosed. McCartney's lawyer, Michael Jacobs, announcing that Sony and McCartney, quote, have resolved this matter by entering into a confidential settlement agreement, and that McCartney's lawsuit over the catalog had been dismissed, leaving it unclear what portion of the catalog has been regained by Paul. With the possibility it's a gradual time correlating to the years the songs were published, or it's a whole package with Paul paying some substantial amount on it. Also, how much of the rights has he regained back? Because Paul could only claim a 50% stake via court as part half of the Lennon-McCartney songwriter partnership. Yoko Ono, as the John Lennon estate, had already cut a deal with Sony in 2009 and relinquished Lennon's right to regain publishing until 70 years after Lennon's death, which would be 2050. So, did Paul also buy Lennon's half and/or the other half part still acquired by Sony? Another complication is that the law only applies to the US, so if both parties have resolved the Copyright Act without further agreement, it means Paul would only have rights for the North American market, but not worldwide. unless their settlement resolved this disparity as well. Either way, it appears Paul McCartney has, at least in his mind, come to a conclusion that sorts to resolve this 53-year-long battle to reclaim the songs he created and that had defined him for the world. A feat that will surely secure his lasting legacy of music for generations to come. Thanks for watching The Detail. Check out other videos we have on Michael Jackson and his other famous feuds. Links to them are on the screen now. Until next time, have a good one.